first speaker lurking in the background. So let's introduce him. Our first speaker is well known to most of us. He's an outstanding, inspirational motivator. He is a former teacher, school leader. His list of employment is incredible. He was a director of children's services for Stirling Council, a head of education in East Lothian, and an area manager providing support for schools in Fife, a performance review manager, responsible for quality assurance. He's now a consultant and speaker, and we're so privileged to have him. And he is David Cameron, the real David Cameron. David, good morning. How are you?
I'm cool. I'm good. I was here a fortnight ago because my life's completely out of control. I'm suffering from early onset dementia, I think. So I was trying to broadcast a fortnight ago, but failed. So finally, today I'm catching up. So, yeah.
We're so glad to have you here.
I woke up last Saturday to messages from David, and I thought I'd got it wrong myself. I was in a mad panic, but delighted to have you here today, David. So you're going to offer our morning keynote. So we're going to leave you to us, and you're going to inspire us and set us up for the day. Are you ready, David?
I'm ready. The last thing I'm going to do is inspire you guys, because my message comes accompanied by Johnny Rotten and the Sex Pistols. And there it is. That's my message. My message is never mind the bollocks. And that was a bit of anarchy in the UK, which is exactly what we've got at the moment. So if anybody hasn't heard this talk before, here's the bollocks I'm talking about. I think we're full at the moment of this, of unjustified and aggressive certainty. And if you're on EduTwitter, you'll be exposed to it on a regular basis. Everybody knows better than you what the right way to do things is. And whether they're trads, whether they're progs, whatever the hell they are, everybody's absolutely sure that they're right. And we get so much of that stuff going on. We also suffer from monoliteracy. That's people who've only read one book and they think it's the Bible. We've got another condition related to that called latest book disease. That's somebody who's just come across Doug Lemoff and he thinks it's Genesis, or they've come across Paul Dix and they think he's the Messiah. You know, all of that stuff that goes on. And we've got this, you know, that it worked in Uzbekistan, their PISA status went through the roof. We should all be doing that because we're just like the Uzbekistanis. So we've got that stuff going on. And this, and I want to take just a wee bit of time on this because I think it's hugely important in Scotland. We've got the view in Scotland, I think, that there's a systemic solution for everything. So at the moment, we've got Ken Muir, former chief executive, General Teaching Council, leading a review, looking at SQA, Education Scotland, all of that, getting into the purposes of education. And what happens in Scotland is that every time we have problems, instead of confronting them, we come up with a systemic solution, whether that's curriculum for excellence, higher still, standard grade, 5 to 14, whatever it might be. We come up with changes in the system. And what that means is that everybody has to change. It increases workload for everybody because we've got a new curriculum, we've got new assessment measures, it affects everyone. And that, for me, sits really badly along Fiona Ledbetter's contention from earlier this morning that there's a great deal of good practice in our schools. So why are we challenging that? Why are we not challenging those areas where we are having difficulties or having problems? My view would be that any changes around the broad view of education will probably take us back to where we were with Curriculum for Excellence way back in the 2000s up to about 2010. It'll take us back to purpose, it'll take us back to all of that. But instead of that, we're continuing this quest for the silver bullet change, and Richard Gerver will talk about that this afternoon, which will mean change for everyone, not challenge in the areas where challenge is required. And that sits along that concern that there is no other way. And my view very much is the view of Father Ted. I think we should be down with this sort of thing, because honestly, there is far too much of it, and it is becoming a distraction, I think. So a few fireworks there to add up my few thoughts. Here's the first. You know, there's a view around that testing will save us all. Scottish Government very keen on it, wanted a test at age 5 so that we could get a label on kids, we could plan their learning accordingly and appropriately, measure their progress. I believe they're working on a test that can be administered in the womb so that there's absolutely no time wasted at the point of delivery. We can get them on the right level, we can get them in the right provision, and we can measure the progress they're making straight up from there. And then we get that. That it's the curriculum, stupid. If we could just get the curriculum right, everything would be fine. We'd get all of that sorted. And an alternative view which says it's the stupid curriculum. So both of these views exist simultaneously in the world of education. And then that view that we know the best that's been thought and taught and all of that stuff, that's what we should be passing on. And another view that that's basically a kind of knowledge-based curriculums, a form of nationalist, class-driven colonialism of the mind. You take your own choice where you stand in these issues. But there's stuff like this, isn't there? That we need to prepare young people for a world of incessant change, because the coming of the tablet, the iPad, the iPhone, all of that, virtual reality, that's much more demanding than living through two world wars, the Great Depression, the rise of fascism, collapse empire, all that other stuff that my mum and her parents lived through. We get this, one of my favourites. We need to educate people for jobs that have not yet been invented. That's weird, isn't it? I mean, what does that mean? What's a job that hasn't been invented yet? The one I always choose is husky jockey. There's nobody competing on the racetracks riding huskies. That's a job that hasn't been invented yet. Service and Doctor Who screwdriver, I have no idea. But apparently, we actually need lorry drivers, a job that's been invented for some time. We need fruit pickers. We need people who can fix your sink. It's very little comfort if your bath is bust and you're flooding the downstairs flat and you're looking up in Yellow Pages and it's full of people who can't help you because they've only been trained for a job that doesn't yet exist. And yet we say these things as if they had meaning. And it would be really easy, wouldn't it, to educate people for jobs that haven't yet been invented, because you'll get away with murder. When you're dealing in the world of the absurd and the meaningless, anything makes sense. And this, I love this, operate first. It's the medical equivalent of teach first, which hasn't yet penetrated Scotland, but widely used in the US and elsewhere in the UK. Operate first. That's the medical version. That's somebody that hasn't actually got a medical degree, but has watched Casualty and is therefore fit to begin to operate on you. You wouldn't have lawyers first, would you? You wouldn't have defend first, but we have teach first, because what that does is it reduces teaching to a mechanistic activity which can be picked up in some sort of practical apprenticeship. And we need to think carefully about how far we accept these ideas. Teach First has brought some really talented, bright people into the profession, particularly in England, and it has made a difference. But they struggle with the wider canvas of teaching and education. And we've also got this. We've got this vocabulary of exhortation. And honestly, motivational speaking is becoming a plague. It's worse than COVID. They're all over the place. There's always some tosser out there who's telling you how you can do better and telling you what you should be doing. And often they haven't taught for quite some time. Often they're out with the classroom. Often they've not got any recent experience of dealing with those smaller creatures known as children. And yet they're there because there's that irritating cult of perfection. That somebody out there is doing it absolutely right, it just doesn't happen to be you. And we've got that. We've got so many different varieties of improvement. I think when I started at Teacher Training College, I think there were about 3 education books at that time, and I can't even remember what they were. Now, there's 3 published daily. There is a bewildering array of education books out there. So many different ways that you can get better. And my favourite, which some of you will have heard me talk about before, people telling you to work smarter. And if people tell you to work smarter, I keep giving the same advice. Just reach out, grab the loose clothing in the upper part of their body, pull them sharply towards you and stick your head right in their face, because that's all they deserve. Who gets up in the morning and says, I'm going to go to school and work stupid? Answer, and nobody. So when people tell you to work smarter, they're patronising you. It's like when people tell you to do more with less. Sure, Christ the Saviour managed that at the wedding feast at Canaan, where he fed 5,000 people with nothing more than 5 loaves and 2 fishes. But the bad news, guys, is you're not the Messiah. You cannot do that. We cannot do more with less. It is patronising garbage and needs to be recognised as such. Because what that does, takes me into your warnings. Some reasons to be doubtful. And my advice to the people who are doing all that stuff is, yeah, they should get back into bed, because there are so many people who are promoting something, who are basically selling something. And that selling, that commitment, I think is fundamentally disruptive a lot of the time. Because what it does is it avoids us dancing with dichotomies. It prevents us from engaging with the true complexity of teaching and learning, which isn't about doing things one way or another. The best way forward is not either or. The best way forward is either and. And if you've come through COVID, this presentation is for you if you never want to hear the phrase new normal again. I mean, honest to God, if it's new, it's not normal. If it's normal, it's not new. People saying this stuff need to get over themselves. And that, if the thought of reinventing education post-COVID evokes the cry of gears peace for you, great. Because how many times have we reinvented it? And yet the experience of children and young people in many of our schools is exactly the same as it always was. And it's also for you if you think the main symptom of COVID could be overwork. The work that went into schools to support communities, to build learning, to take different approaches was absolutely remarkable. And maybe politicians need to be vaccinated with that reality rather than vaccinated against COVID. And if you've ever asked the question, why is it always you who has to be resilient? This presentation's for you as well, because that's a real buzzword, isn't it, in schools at the moment. We need to be more resilient. We need to make pupils more resilient, all of that stuff. Why is it always you? Because it's certainly no him, right? You're stressed. You're running your legs off. You're doing your very best. There's Jacob Rees-Mogg kipping in his double-breasted suit on the leather green benches and sitting next to the star of I'm a Celebrity, Get Me Out of Here, Nadine Dorries, who's now the Minister of Culture. The people who should be under pressure don't appear to be under the pressure that you are. And he looks a lot more relaxed than you do. And I just gave him a wee jolt there, just out of pure spite. So that's what's happening in my world and yours. Huge issues around retention rates for staff. I've been talking to a young woman who started in a secondary school relatively near me last week. They were on something known as Code Red. The police were brought into the school. Stress is a massive factor. Retention rates low, absence high, and many of you feeling that your work invades other aspects of your life. And I'm not going to go into the colourful elements of that, as I often do, because we don't have a lot of time for it. But I've become really concerned about that we ask people to be resilient to cope with the unpalatable, the unsupportable, and the intolerable. We do it in society where it's the poor who are asked to be resilient. And we do that rather than really seriously think about the redistribution of wealth. It's more straightforward for us to celebrate the resilience of survivors, and we do it all the time. We fetishize those who've overcome adversity, but they are the exceptions rather than the rule. And what we don't do is we don't change the circumstances that they had to defeat to get to where they are now. And we really need to wake up to that, because that, I think, has parallels for what's happening for teachers in schools. We're offering you breathing. You know, you can go in courses and you'll be told how to breathe better. I once sat through somebody talking about finger breathing, where you ran your one finger up the side of your thumb, you breathed in accordance with the movement of your finger. And as the person who was demonstrating got to the last finger, a voice from the audience said, "I've no got enough sodden fingers to breathe away the shit I'm dealing with." And I had more sympathy with the heckler than I did with the speaker. Because that's what we're looking at. Well-being treated as the result of tackling what makes you anxious. That's what we need. We don't need well-being helping us to deal with anxiety. We need it through dealing with those things that makes us anxious. And I think that resilience, and the way we speak about it, feels like the philosophy of the Titanic, that it's not up to them to provide the lifeboats. It's up to you to find one. If we're serious about that, we need to recognise that. And I'm grateful for the person who produced this slide for me. But the real answer to well-being is job satisfaction. If we want to get job satisfaction in the teaching profession, what we need to do is offer people clarity to stop bombarding them with systemic change and initiativitis and give them the chance to adhere to key and core principles, to offer clarity around those things that make a difference, and to give them time. And if anything is picked up from the recent OECD review, it should be the reduction of teaching time. Because if we can get that, we can increase the quality of professional development and we can genuinely make a difference to what we do in the classroom because of what we do outside the classroom, where we have time to think, to reflect, and to build on what we have already achieved. But the reality of COVID was that, like a game of buckaroo, and for anybody not old enough to remember it, that's a board game where you load stuff onto a donkey until it finally bucks it off. And I think over the last year and a half, more and more has been loaded onto you, and more probably has got bucked off. We've had changing rules, we've had varying guidance. It always arrived too late, it changed too quickly. We've had the assessment hokey-cokey, you know, put the whole exam in, you take the whole exam out, you do the whole thing with continuous assessment, but you shake it all about. People don't know where they stand, people had no clarity. The workload was intense and ridiculous and the expectations were absolutely unrealistic. And we were dealing with all of that while dealing with pupil absences, which meant that consistency in teaching and learning was undermined. Staff absences, which really in many schools came close to breaking the back of what we were doing. People were faced with parental pressures, do more, do less, give us less. Parents really felt under pressure themselves and often transferred that to schools. And many of them finally recognised exactly how much you did and praised you for it. And that was welcome. Most schools spent time just picking up the pieces, not in terms of learning only, but in terms of everything. Schools became a central part of the strategy for maintaining the strengths within communities and addressing the weaknesses and failures. And by the end of it, I'm sure we all felt that somebody could do with bucking off. So that's the reality we've come through. And I've used this slide a million times, but that's the reality we're enduring. On my left, possibly your right, I have no idea how this works. That's how schools used to be, head in charge, leading the school forward in a clear direction, the deputy at the back clearing up the crap. On the other side, that's what you're like now. Everything, and I've said this a million times, is your responsibility in schools. You're expected to defeat terrorism, you know, by making sure that kids aren't radicalised, you're supposed to address domestic violence, all of that, and all worthwhile causes. But you're doing them at the same time you're trying to teach kids to read, get a few hires, do all of that. And you're also expected to get them to eat lettuce, run a daily mile. None of these things in themselves, difficult or problematic, But to try and do them all, as somebody quoted me on Twitter the other day, means that there is no such thing as a priority, because everything's a priority. And I keep maintaining that this song represents the reality for many of us in education today.
You doesn't love me too much, baby.
Message for Shirley and some of them.
Why can't you see what you're going to be? When you don't believe what I say.
And that's the key point, that we've never been more accountable nor more exposed. Whether or not it's subject to inspection, internal quality assurance processes, we have more people assuring quality than we have delivering it, probably. But that's the reality. And that sense of suspicion is addressed by central interference in all that we do. It's addressed by the attacking teacher agency, which is often led by the demands that are on us. People can talk as much as they like about creating teacher agency. What they're often doing is creating more activity and more responsibility. So we're caught in a trap. And unlike the song, we need to make sure that we get out. And we need to avoid this.
Who's that shadow holding me hostage? I've been here for days. Who's this whispered?
And I feel that that's true about so much, that so many of us have got Stockholm Syndrome. We moan, we bitch, we do all of that, but then we go on with it. And the people often who are most energetic and most thorough in meeting the new demands and the new systemic changes are those who are already knackered from delivering excellence. And they are truly delivering excellence. So let's
doing
think differently.
Right. Everybody will be dancing and we'll
let's make
it right.
Sure
everybody will
that
be dancing
Bruce got
and we'll
into
right. Everybody will be dancing
we
and we're feeling all right. Everybody will be dancing tonight, doing it right. Everybody will be dancing and we're feeling it right. Everybody will be dancing and be doing it right. Everybody will be dancing and we're feeling all right. Everybody will be dancing tonight, doing it right.
I mean, I hope that groove's working for you guys, because it's certainly working for me. And this, if we're going to do it right, if we're going to get out of that trap that I spoke about earlier, here's how we make the great escape. No apologies for repeating this. We get out of the great escape by agreeing what matters, and we should bombard Ken Muir's review with some clarity around what we believe matters and makes a difference. What are the key pillars in education that actually make a difference in outcomes for children? And the reason I've put in that second issue about what mattered is I think that COVID and the experience that we've had of COVID has brought some clarity. When we couldn't do everything, what were the things that we thought were a priority? And all of that enhances my great plea all the time to agree what the breakable plates are. Because we're spinning so many, some of them are going to drop anyway. And the ones that dropped during COVID, during lockdown, did you miss them? So let's use the clarity that came from crisis, not to reimagine education in some new form that will place additional demands on us. Let's use it to get some clarity about what the fundamentals are so that we can restore as much as we reinvent. And let's make sure that we do that. That if we haven't already established it, let's do that now. If we have, let's recover the subtraction habit. Because I worry that going beyond, which is what you did through the lockdown period, then becomes this dreadful phrase, the new normal, that the expectation becomes that we can function at the level that we functioned at in crisis. No activity should be determined by how it's reflected in crisis. And yet that often becomes the case. So let's get back to these key principles. The principle of manageability. Asking not what must be done or what should be done, but asking first and foremost what can be done. Let's have some clarity around that. Let's get some coherence. Let's get some pillars, some key ideas, some key principles, which will tie together the initiatives that come through. And whatever changes are made, if they cannot be related to those key principles and pillars, then they should be ignored and set aside. And let's base everything that we do on the concept of consonance, where we start from our ambitions and commitments and then look outside to see what expectations we're expected to meet. Too often we do it the other way around. What is it that HMI want? What is it that Education Scotland are promoting? Let's get it the other way round. Let's start from the ambitions. And remember, all of these were issues before COVID, before lockdown. This is an ongoing discussion. And when we have that discussion, let's think in context, because our schools are radically different, our situations are radically different. And that will be illustrated through today in the presentations that you see and hear. We need to think in context, and we need to think both in the old context, how things were before the crisis of the last 18 months or whatever, as well as the new. Because it's only by thinking what the children and young people need in the communities which we serve that we will get clarity about what steps we need to take. And just remember, whatever anybody says, this crisis over the pandemic ain't over till it's over. We've already got the Delta variant. We've got the South African variant. God knows what's coming down the line. And we need to think realistically about what we can meet as challenge. If we're already overstretched, we cannot handle exceptional demand. So what does this mean as you go through today? It means this. It means doing more of the things that you know work. And I get really distracted, and I made that clear earlier. When the basis for evidence-based research becomes somebody else's evidence, where it becomes what we've read in books or what we've seen on YouTube or what we've heard from some motivational tosser who happens to have turned up to deliver a message for you. The key thing about evidence-based practice must be that it deploys practice-based evidence, that it involves us looking at what we've done and how that's worked, informed by the outside research, by all means. But the fundamental determinant will be the reality of what we've tried, what we've seen, and what's worked. So we need to be clear about that. We need to be clear. We need to find out what works for us in our context. And that means understanding our context. That means an awareness of what the young people that we're dealing with bring to school, what they bring for their communities. And then let's get the energy from doing what we believe in. And generally, I think people who come along to events like this, online or in person, come along because they believe in the possibility of better. Often, it's because education has given you a life better than the life your parents had or your grandparents had. You want to continue that tradition. And yet the challenges that are facing us in terms of poverty, differences in inequality and all of that are much greater and much more challenging than they've ever been. So like today with ScotEd 2, it's about sharing and applying. It's about picking up ideas. It's about sharing your own. It's about discussing experience and sharing that. But ultimately, it has to be about applying, reflecting and sharing again. And please, let's base it on informed ambition, not a quest for perfection, but a sense of achieving what's possible. And when we make comparisons, let's make aspirational ones, ones that are not beyond us, ones that can be achieved, but ones that we believe are possible. And as we do that, the graph, any activity that can be plotted on that graph, let's see where it comes in terms of time and effort. Let's see where it comes in terms of impact. Because those things that come high on the time and effort axis are simply breakable plates. And those that come far along the impact line are the things that matter. Let's use tools like that rather than continually importing demand. Let's replace demand with analysis, and let's genuinely commit to responding to that analysis by asking these really big questions. What is it you do? Why do you do it? What's your motivation? What's your belief? And then the fundamental evaluative question, why do you keep doing it? What are the things that you believe in sufficiently to sustain? And if we get the answers to these questions, we've got a way forward to make these decisions. Not what we must do, nor what should we do. We can ask that, but we can only ask it alongside what can we do. We then need to say, is there a difference? And if there is, and we can't do what we should do, let's make sure that we ask the question what we can stop doing. And finally, the question, what must we keep doing? And that's the critical thing for me. It's not importing the novel, but it's building on the foundations and taking them forward in a gradualist way. And I'm supported in that by John Hattie. John Hattie very clear in this quote about not looking for a silver bullet, but looking simply to know the nature and magnitude of your impact in the learning of your students. That's both your inspiration and your beacon. Because as he says, no program, no single script, no workbook on how to implement visible learning. It's a set of benchmarks that can be used to create debate, to seek evidence, to self-review, and to determine whether school is having a marked impact on all of its students. It's a much simpler and clearer process. So as I said at the start, let's never mind the bollocks. Let's look to the reality. And let's base it on a clear philosophy. And there's mine, that the focus should always be on the experience of the learner, that the quality, the features of quality can be recognised. We do know what works. We can describe it. We can categorise it. We then need to build that in because it can't be inspected into the system. We need to be self-evaluative. We need to direct improvement in the basis of that. And our judgments need to be based on evidence of outcomes. And that should be qualitative as well as quantitative. We mustn't be reduced to simply data. We need quality and complexity as well. And that will give us a rational-based model that's beyond intuition, but doesn't get us trapped into the hamster wheel of data pursuit. Because that's my belief at the end, that improvement's most effective when it's part of a shared enterprise and where we agree about the outcomes. And today's a brilliant opportunity to begin that sharing. And ask these four questions. What are you going to do to improve your practice? What help or support will you need? What outcomes will you look for? What evidence will you look at? For me, that's the way past to see both the illusions and the delusions. It's not Luddite. Let's be informed by research. Let's be led by evidence. But let's make sure that we're absolutely clear about who we are. In case you're wondering what's been going on, I've been asking you to dream and to believe.
I could have
I've been the real David Cameron. I hope I've been on fire for some of this. There's my contact details, my website, my Twitter account, and my mobile list. Really awesome. Enjoy the monkeys. Enjoy your days. Let's roll out the ball. And I'm done.
Good. What a start. Thank you so much. The comments were rolling in, such some disagreement, some agreement. It was truly an incredible start. Some applause. What else have we got? Let me see, trying to roll through all these comments. There was so many of them. Somebody upset.
So passionate and
smarter. That seemed to resonate with so many people, what you said there, David. Fiona, what was Twitter like? Have we got any questions for David?
We have some questions about time to do the reading, time to do the important stuff, and getting how do we get around that? And I'm pretty much in agreement that we do need to engage in our core purpose of what education's for and why we're doing that, but How do we do it?
Well, I mean, two things. One is we need to focus on asking for it. And if we're going to get behind anything in the OECD report, and it's really interesting, isn't it, that there's been an immediate response in setting up that review group to look at the structure of the SQA, to look at Education Scotland, all of that. Where's the follow-up to the recommendation about workforce and the issue about the high demand for teaching, for contact teaching in Scottish schools, higher than anywhere else? Now, we need to get behind that. And we need to make sure that the EIS and the other teachers' unions get behind that as well. So there's a big job there in terms of what we ask for. The second thing that we need to do around that is we need to do that simple exercise with a graph. You can use quadrants for it or whatever. But people need to regularly sit down in their department meetings and say, what is it that we're doing that we don't need to be doing because it's not making a difference? And time spent doing that, I think, brings rewards further down the line. I think the other thing, Fiona, for me, is Darren's doing some brilliant stuff at Bell Baxter, where what he's done is he's looking at the real situation, the real context in the school in terms of children's achievements in numeracy and mathematics, and then he's dealing with that. Now, what will happen with that is that problems which would otherwise linger and be a constant demand on teachers right across the curriculum might actually get solved. And it's where we actually address concerns, confront the reality of problems, we gain time from that. But ultimately, we do need to be released, in a sense, with more time for Scottish teachers. And that means an expansion of the workforce.
It certainly does.
Darren and I had that very conversation the other night, didn't we? We were talking about the work that you're doing with your maths pupils. And I think that's really, really important, isn't it, to look at where the root of the problem is and not just stick a plaster on it. And we've talked about that so many times, really digging deeper to work out how we can solve the root of the problem. Yeah, absolutely.
Comment just came in from Andrew Billy about Higios. Higios must go for me to create more simplicity in what actually matters. David, I really love your thoughts on that idea.
Yeah, I mean, what we've done is we started off with the quaintly named Higios, right? And then we created, it's like Ian Rankin, you know, if it stopped at one Rebus novel, the world would be a different place. How many Higioses are there? I mean, there's a Higios for everything. I'm sure there's a Higios for toilet training. It's just something that's mushroomed. And it's that point about the obsession with accountability, right? I mean, the reality is if people are achieving outcomes for children, and that's not simply measured in exam attainment or whatever else, if people are achieving outcomes for children, actually matters less how they do it. And what we need is we need much more direct engagement around these simple questions that I was trying to ask. And that's where Higios started. You know, Higios started with what's your practice like? How are you doing it? All of that stuff. And yet it's got lost, as Andrew's pointing out, in a whole set of QIs. How many bloody, excuse me, I mean, I'm on a rant, so I might as well go. How many bloody QIs do you need? And of course, you need a lot because it's supporting a significant workforce in terms of Education Scotland, teaching and learning. And what did we get? You know, when there was concern about the middle tier, we got the RICs. And some of the RICs are doing fabulous work. But, you know, it sounds like some Stalinist creation from the Soviet Union, circa 1930, that nobody understands. And what's the relationship between a RIC and a local authority? Where does the power actually lie? We introduce confusion into the system continually with that quest for systemic solutions, where we need to confront practical realities. Clear away a lot of that, Toss. Thank you, Andrew. You've inspired me to even greater grumpiness than I'd achieved in my own.
Just conscious of time, we've got Lynn Taylor in the background waiting to go on. But David, thank you so much. We're going to leave it there with that, what Christine Cowser says about do less, but do it better. And I think that resonated through. And just a couple of things. Hazel Heffalump says, three cheers for David. What a start to the day. Stephanie Peach says, well done, David. A passionate start to the day. Teacher's Pet says, thank you. G Dixo 59, thanks. Really thought-provoking. And Christine Kauser always inspires. So for me and Fiona...
Kauser is too kind. Let's just be absolutely clear about that. Thanks for having me, guys. I'll get on Twitter and respond to as many as I can. So
definitely. If you want to get involved further in the chat, please use David's Twitter handle, which is @RealDavidCameron and hashtag Scott. Sorry?
It's @RealDCameron.
Oh, sorry, @RealDCameron. Sorry, I got that just slightly wrong. Thank you very much. @RealDCameron. And please use the hashtag ScottEd2 so that people can follow that throughout the day. So, David, thank you so, so much for joining us and kicking off our day with such energy and enthusiasm.
Thank you.